Houston, will they stay in Houston? Absolutely. But there's still that frustration and a bit of anger that they weren't afforded the opportunity to return home and make the standard of living and the kind of living they deserved. So, you know, folks want to play with numbers. I won't play with numbers. I play with lives. I don't play with lives, but we talk about lives and we say, that's what I want folks to focus in on.
Well, Tracie Washington, civil rights attorney and president of the Louisiana Justice Institute, will be back in a minute. We're joined now by two guests from New Orleans. Jordan Flaherty is a New Orleans-based writer and community organizer. His book is Floodlines, Community and Resistance from Katrina to the Jena Six. We're also joined by Tracie Washington, civil rights attorney and president of the Louisiana Justice Institute. Jordan, in your book, Floodlines, you tell many, many stories of communities surviving and resisting in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina. Talk about what happened to the education system in New Orleans.
Well, the education system certainly had problems before Katrina, as Tracie talked about. The teachers were not paid well. The system was tragically underfunded. It was not a working system. But what happened after Katrina is you had a complete shift in the system. So pre-Katrina, you had 128 schools. 124 of them were under the control of the school board. After the storm, the first thing that happened was the entire staff of the school system was fired. All the teachers, janitors, cafeteria workers, 7,000-plus employees were fired. Their union, which was the largest union in the city, was derecognized. It was also probably the largest source of black political power in the city. It ceased to exist. The schools were then taken away from the control of the school board, so that now there's five schools under the school board, and the rest are under a combination of either the state or various charters. So we have this, what Superintendent Paul Vallis has called this 100% choice system, what he proudly calls a free market system. And that, I think, is a microcosm of what we've seen in all these aspects of the post-Katrina New Orleans, where it's this survival of the fittest system. We do have excellent schools in the city now, but you need to have parents that can go out and research and get their applications in and get you into the right schools. We have some great health care available, but there's no one health care system that provides indigent, poor, you know, free health care for indigent folks. That's been taken away. You know, so we have some wonderful housing available, but it costs a lot more now. And if you, you know, live in a home that was damaged, if you lived in a white neighborhood, you got the full amount of money to rebuild. If you lived in an African-American neighborhood, you didn't get the money to rebuild. So it's this survival of fittest. If you lived in the French Quarter or the Central Business District, or you go to the Lower Garden District, those areas were very quickly rebuilt, even though they didn't flood it. They didn't flood. You go to the Lower Ninth Ward, these areas that were hit the most, Gentilly, New Orleans East, they still haven't recovered. So it's like the recovery support went to those that needed the least. And that's, I think, fundamentally what we've seen as a problem with this whole recovery. And that's why I think there's important lessons for people to learn around the country from New Orleans, not just if you're scared of a hurricane, but if you're concerned about any of these issues, housing, health care, criminal justice, education, because we saw these issues in New Orleans, but we saw them played out on hyperspeed, on fast speed. Suddenly all the teachers fired. Suddenly all the public housing closed up and shuttered up and the people not allowed back in. Suddenly all the schools taken away from local control and put under state control and transferred over to this charter system. Virtually overnight these changes happened. But I think there's a lot to learn, not just from the problems, but also from the solutions, from this organizing that people did here in New Orleans. And I talked a little bit ago about what happened on criminal justice organizing, but there's incredible organizing that's happened, from people working on these issues of housing and education, people that have fought for a just reconstruction of the city, people like Tracie Washington, culture workers that have been organizing on the front lines, like Sunny Patterson, who have been doing amazing cultural work and have also been community organizers, folks like CES45, who have been not just participating in the events, but organizing a lot of this response. And so there's important positive lessons, I think, for people around the country concerned about these issues to learn from.
Jordan, in a recent article you wrote, you cite a statistic from the recent survey of New Orleanians by the Kaiser Family Foundation about the racial disparity in terms of understandings of recovery. 42% of African Americans versus just 16% of whites say they have still not recovered from Hurricane Katrina. Tracie Washington, we've just got a few minutes left with you. You've talked about the right to recovery as opposed to recovery as a privilege. Explain what you mean.
Especially here, and following, I guess, a little bit on what Jordan was saying, this right to recovery really evolves from United Nations principles, but it is embodied in sort of the type of economy and how we lived here in New Orleans and really all along the Gulf Coast. We had a social services infrastructure in place here that supplemented health care and education and transportation because we worked people poor, right? We had so many low-wage workers, and we were an impoverished city. Granted, we had lots of wealthy people here, but those wealthy people really made money off of the labor of poor folk. We took away the entire social services infrastructure, but still expected people to work poor and live really poor, except now it was much more difficult. When we talk, therefore, about a right to recovery, we mean principally that the folks who were here prior to Katrina, those folks who were worked poor, all of us really have a right to be returned, not just to where we were prior to Hurricane Katrina, but we have those same rights principally to education, to housing, to health care, to voting, right? All of these things should be human rights for us, and they've not been restored. And for so many of us who are principled and moral, and so many activists, all of whom I couldn't possibly name here, we sit and we look in these faces every day. We look at these children who are being horribly underserved and undereducated, and we don't say just 365 days from now, but what's going to happen 3 years from now and 36 years from now? What's going to happen with their lives? And if we simply take the time to have a principled recovery based on these rights, basic human rights, we would be so much better off. And in fact, we would be that model city that the president, our governor, our mayor, and our senior senator continue to falsely say we are. We are not there yet, but we can get there.
Well, Tracie Washington, we'll have to leave it there. Thank you so much for joining us, president of the Louisiana Justice Institute.